Miss Neal, tell me why you decided to write your book.
I thought it was time. No, I didn't really. I spent a lot of time at a divine nunnery called... It's in Bethlehem, and it's a divine one. It's called Abbey of Virginal Daughters. And I think that they were so tired of hearing me complain. And they said, why don't you write a book? So I wrote one with the help of Mother Dolores. She's the divine, you know, you remember who Mother Dolores was? Mother Dolores Hart. She was a divine actress. I love her. She's divine.
She was in Where the Boys Are and all
those.
Oh,
yes. Good actress.
Coming from the stage as you did, how did you have to change your acting style for the screen?
Well, I didn't know. I had no idea what to do, you know. And I'm sure that was John Loves Mary. And then when I did The Fountainhead, I began to work with a coach, and his name was George Thonoff, and he was the Russian. And he helped me greatly. He really was good, you know. He is now dead, as who's not dead, everybody I know is almost. But he was very good, you know, and I love doing that film.
Why?
Well, that was my second film. And the fact I got it was astonishing because I'd done John Loves Mary, and I was just walking on the set, and not the set, the what do I call it? The just the
in the studio.
No, it was on the ground of the studio, and I was walking, and all of a sudden, this man riding a bicycle, he stopped. And we began to talk. And I had no idea who he was, but I'm a friendly woman. And I don't know, we talked for about 15 minutes or 20 minutes, and he said to me, I'd like you to test for The Fountainhead. Ah, I was so thrilled. I was so thrilled. So I began working with George Thonoff then, because I'd done a scene just for him, you know, without anything better to do. Someone wanted me to work with him. When I got the part, I worked with George Thonoff, and he was a very good man.
And who was the man on the bicycle?
Oh, that was the director. His name was King Vidor. A lovely man he was.
And he was from the old school. He was from silent pictures.
Oh, yes. He was fun, though. He was really good.
Now, he introduced you to your leading man in The Fountainhead, and who was that?
His name was Gary Cooper.
Tell me about Mr. Cooper.
Well, I love Gary Cooper. I loved him always. I'd had lunch at the Warner, at his great luncheon. What was his name? Jack Warner. At his luncheon at the studio, and I had a lot of actors, and it was great. And I sat across from Gary Cooper when I did the screen test for The Fountainhead, and I got it. I know that Jack, the director, he had invited me to meet Gary Cooper, and we had talked, and then. And then Gary Cooper came and watched me do a scene from it. And then we went to we went to...
Was that the quarry?
The quarry. You're so good. We started at the quarry. That was the first thing we shot. I fell in love with Gary Cooper. I loved him always. And I will always love him. You know, he was the love of my life.
What can you describe him to us physically?
Oh, well, I mean, he was so beautiful. I loved his looks. I mean, I loved his eyes. Well, they were beautiful. And he was witty. He really was. He was great fun. And I just adored him.
What color eyes?
Oh, they were blue, baby, and they were beautiful blue.
Is it true that Barbara Stanwyck was interested in your role in The Fountainhead?
Well, yes, she thought she had it. And when she heard I had it, she left Warner Brothers. She was angry with them. And then I did not see her, you know, until years later when I'd had my stroke. And I was at the Beverly Hills Hotel, and we were in the dining room, and Barbara Stanwyck, I had word that she wanted to talk to me. So I was taken to her table, and she said to me, "You are a great woman. I admire you so much," you know, and that was so good coming from her, because she resented the fact that I got that part, but she was the divine woman to me in the end.
Because I think she'd found the property or brought the property to Warner Brothers and sort of nursed it along and was...
Oh, had she?
...ready to jump
no
right in there.
No one told me that. That's very interesting.
Now, after your relationship with Gary Cooper, was that one of the reasons you left Hollywood?
Life was hell. It really was. It was beautiful to begin with. I remember that I was frightened of airplanes at that point in my life, not now at all. But I'd taken the train from Knoxville, Tennessee, my old hometown, through to Pasadena. And I was met by an agent. And he took me to the Bel Air Hotel, which was where I lived to begin with. Wow, it was so fabulous to go to this great hotel and past the water and everything and great peace. It was beautiful, beautiful, beautiful. And I thought, that I was in heaven. But after 5 years, it didn't turn out to be that way. So I decided to leave Hollywood. And I left without a job. And I came to New York. Got a cheap room. I was reading in the paper that Kermit Blumgarten was going to do the Lee and Hellman play, the first one she wrote. And so I called Kermit and I said, "Kermit, may I read for that?" And he said, "Yeah, you come read if you want to."
So you were cast in The Children's Hour.
Yes, The Children's Hour. It was... I had, the idea of being in it was so good to me. And as I said, Kermit said, "Yeah, you can come and read if you want to." So I read it, and I read so magnificently, they let me choose which part I played. And I chose to play Martha. And that is, one that's accused of being a lesbian, and I kill myself in the end. Which I like doing. I think that's what I wanted, someplace to kill myself at that point in my life.
And yet you were almost starting a new life in New York
to
get away.
Yes, I was. That's what I was doing.
And I want to step back a little bit and ask you what it feels like to see yourself on screen for the first time.
It was just so funny, you know. I mean... imagine looking at yourself doing all this, and I didn't know a lot about films, you know, at that point in my life. But I learned at that first one, and when I did The Fountainhead, I knew a lot more than I did when I did John Loves Many.
Let's talk about some of the characters that you played. I want you to describe them. Dominique in The Fountainhead, what was she like?
Oh, I was cold, but I wasn't really. I was passionate, you know, that's really, it was a good part. I loved playing it, really, and that's all I can tell you.
Marcia in A Face in the Crowd.
I love doing that. It's just that, you see, I was a member of the Actors Studio, and I had done a scene from Cat on the Hot Tin Roof. And I did it so magnificently, they let me play Barbara Borghetti's part when she was going on holiday in Ireland. So I played it, and Elia liked me in it so much that he put me in A Face in the Crowd. And I adored doing it, and I love everybody in it. It was really a beautiful experience I had.
Why did you like doing that so much?
Well, he's a fabulous director. He is really a fantastic man. And my darling leading man.
Andy Griffith.
Andy Griffith is a great one. I love him so much, and he's a beautiful man. Beautiful, and I love doing it. And what was the name of the darling girl?
Lee Remick.
Lee Remick. She was delicious, and it was her first film, and I loved her, you know. And she is no longer. It's very sad.
There was a scene near the end when you go into the control room. Mm-hmm. Do you remember filming that when you're supposed to go in?
I sure do, because he wanted me to, you know, really do it. And he had, I thought, two men pulling me off. I think he had six men trying, and I was holding on. And finally, I had to let go, and I started crying, oh, God. And that's what he wanted.
Do you think Kazan was a better director in the theater or for films, or did it matter?
Oh, he was gorgeous in anything he did. He was a beautiful director. He really was. I think he's the best director I ever worked with. I've worked with about, you know, some others, but if I had to say who was the best one, I think he was the best.
Why?
Well, he knows what it's like to be an actor. He knows how to make you give anything you want. And, of course, Martin Ritt, he was fantastic, too. He was an actor. And actors make better directors, I think, because they know how to get it out of you, you know?
And they know when to back off, when they're telling you too much.
Yeah. Oh, yes, they know it all.
Well, let's move on to HUD and tell me about Alma.
Well, I want to tell you that my daughter Olivia, she had just died from measles, and she was 7 when she died. And, of course, I had to keep working because, you know, one wants M-O-N-E-Y. And I know that I'd gotten a part in Hollywood, just a television thing, and I was there, and Martin Ritt sent me the script, and I knew Martin Ritt from New York. And it was HUD. Well, I wanted very much to do it, but I couldn't stay there all the time because, you know, I had to run my family. And I mean, Rual, he was so upset when Olivia died. He was suicidal. It was just terrible. And Theo was my little baby, and little Tessa, she was, you know, so I had to be home, but I had to earn some money. So I told Marty, I said, I could stay when you need me, but I, you know, couldn't sit around when you don't need me. And he said, that's all right. So he did my scenes first in Texas. And then he let me go home for about 5 weeks.
So Ritt arranged for you to shoot your scenes first, and then you joined the company again back in California?
Yes, I did. That's when we did the rear projection, you know, where the, like in the car, when I say to HUD, little sexy things, you know, about his woman, and that was done in the studio, you know, with the film behind us.
And do you remember how you described Alma?
Oh, God, I don't know how to describe her. She's a she's just a good woman. She's a good woman, and she knows a bad one when she sees one, even though she's a little attracted to him, but I don't give in to that, and that's very good. And it's a loving part. I like it.
And you said at that point in your life, after Olivia's death, that I knew her in my bones.
Yeah, I did. You know, I mean, we got a lot of people in us, you know. We're not just one. And I knew her completely.
And the line, I think you said in your book, they cut this out, what is life all about? Brandon DeWilde asked you, what's life all about, Alma? And you said, honey, you'll just have to ask somebody else.
Yeah. I'm sorry that scene was cut, but they thought it was too much, or they didn't think it was necessary.
And Nettie in the subject with roses. Tell me about Nettie.
I love doing the subject with roses. I didn't want to do it. I didn't want to do it, but Ruel shoved me into it. And I didn't like it in the beginning. You know, I really didn't want to go to rehearsal. But I did what I should do. And then about the third day of rehearsal, I began to like it. And when we shot it, I adored it. It's the greatest thing that ever happened to me. I loved it, you know, and Jack Albertson, he was so divine to me. And Martin Sheen was good, and Ulu Grossbart, and the divine producer whose name was, I'm so great with names, as you know.
And why didn't you want to do that picture? Take us back to why you didn't want to.
Oh, because I didn't feel I could do it, you know.
Why?
Because I had a stroke, and, you know, I just didn't think I can't act again. And Ruel, he shoved me into it. I'm so glad he did, because I adore acting.
Miss Neal, tell me about Breakfast at Tiffany's.
Oh, well, I hadn't done a film for a long time, and I think the producer's wife, she mentioned me, and they thought that was a good idea, so they offered it to me, and I took it, because I had worked with the leading man.
George Peppard.
And I think it would be very good to work with him. I was so thrilled because he'd been so good to me when we'd done a scene at the Actors Studio together. And I thought, oh, I can hardly wait. Well, my darling, he had gotten conceited. And I found it very difficult to work with him. He did not want to be shown as a sissy. And I swear he and the divine director, whose name was?
Blake Edwards.
They almost had a fist fight. They really did. And, I unfortunately opened my mouth, and so he got his way, you know, the one I don't like. But, I really loved him, but not in the end. He was really, he'd gotten so spoiled.
What about Audrey Hepburn?
Audrey, but she was lovely. I really liked her so much. And she's the one who presented the award, which I would have presented had I not had my stroke. And she's the one who took my place.
What does it feel like to be nominated for an Oscar?
Oh, it feels very good, very good. And I was nominated twice. I was nominated for HUD. And then when I did The Subject with Roses, I was nominated again. I did not win that year. That's the year that Katharine Hepburn and Barbara Streisand both won it. And I didn't mind, but I was happy to be nominated.
Now, I know you didn't go to the Oscars when you won for HUD, but I think Theo asked you what an Oscar was. Do you remember?
What did I say?
You said, it's a great golden boy who whispers in your ear what you've known all your life.
What a good thing for me to say. It's a great golden boy, is that right? I was very happy to win that. That was delicious, you know. But I could not go because I had a baby about 3 days later. My darling Ophelia, she was born then.
What is the Actors Studio?
Oh, the actor's studio is a good thing. I do not go there now. I haven't gone for... I did do a scene there, I don't know how many years ago. Was it 4 years ago or 5 years ago? And that was very good. We had a good time doing that. But I just don't go because I have so many other things in my life now. And
who was in charge of it when you were there?
Oh, Lee Strasberg.
Tell me about him.
Oh, I adored Lee Strasberg. He was a fantastic man. I think about 10 of us were kicked out. And I went to Hollywood and I got the letter, don't come anymore. And I was a little hurt, but...
Why were you kicked out?
Oh, because he thought the talented ones, he thought he was keeping the talented ones, but he kicked out a lot of really talented ones. Like Ann Jackson, she was kicked out, and a lot of us. But we were back in.
Robert Lewis?
Yeah, Robert Lewis. He's the one who kicked us out. When I came back from Hollywood, and I was pregnant, my first baby, I desperately wanted to go, and I called Lee Strasberg, and I said, can I please visit? He said, yeah, you can come if you want to. So I came once, then I didn't stop coming. And I did scenes from Romeo and Juliet and from Cat on a Hot Tin Roof. And that's how I got to... but Romeo and Juliet, that went very well indeed. I know it's written with actors... I've seen an article written about the Actors Studio, and they say that... that's one of the four scenes they mention as being the best, which makes me very proud, very proud.
What do you want from a director?
Want him to understand what the character is and what I would do, and I want him, so in case I make any mistakes, not to let me do that, and that sort of thing.
And one of the people we interviewed yesterday said casting is 95% of the directing. If the director has cast you, he knows what you can do and trust you.
That's right. I mean, I can't dance. Can't sing, can't dance.
Tell me about Otto Preminger.
Oh, Otto Preminger. Now, Otto, he was an astonishing man because he was very good to the stars. We were the most beautiful people in the world, and he was very spoiled, you know, he was very kind to us. Anybody who wasn't a star got hell. Oh, he was really horrible to some people. And, but he was, I mean, I have seen him shout to, you know, people, it'd just be horrible. You have no idea, and they weep, they cry. I mean, it's just awful what he could do. But oh, to stars, we were the best. And, you know, and that's true of the people who were who worked on the you know, the lighting men and that sort of thing. I mean, he could, oy, 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 when he told you, I think it was the lighting man almost killed him once because he criticized him or something. I don't know. I was too.
How can you explain the continuing popularity of The Day the Earth Stood Still?
I love The Day. You know, I want to tell you, when I did The Day the Earth Stood Still, I thought it was the most hysterical thing I'd ever done in my life. And I was grinning, and Michael...
Rennie?
Michael Rennie. He would say, excuse me, do you intend to laugh there? And I was like, no, I don't. But I thought it was the funniest thing I'd ever said in my life, you know. But it turned out to be splendid. I think it's a fabulous film. And you know who directed that?
Robert Wise.
Robert Wise directed that. He directed three films. I did. He directed Three Secrets, and then The Day the Earth Stood Still. And I forget the name of the other one, but the divine man was in it with me. Don't remember his name, don't remember any name.
I'll find it.
Something for the birds.
Yes. Something. Yes. Something for the birds.
A memorable picture. What is it like to watch yourself being portrayed in the Patricia Neal story?
Oh, the Patricia Neal story. When I heard that she was going to play me, I didn't like it at all. I wanted an American to play me, and I had a great idea about somebody, and, you know, I suggested, but they said no, and they signed her. Boy, you say it, I. And then I saw it, and I think she did a super job. I really adored her, and I saw her two or three times after that, and a lovely woman, and I'm so sorry she's given up acting.
Glenda Jackson.
Yes, to rule Glenda Jackson. Glenda Jackson rules her country now. No, I think she's a fantastic girl.
Was it unpleasant to watch some of it?
Oh, no, because I'd lived through it. It had happened to me. But I thought she was great in it. And Dirk Bogarde. I remembered him. He used to be a friend of ours. He lived in very near us.
Miss Neal, now you worked at Warner's, MGM, Fox, Paramount, Columbia. Was there one particular studio that you felt more comfortable in?
Well, it should have been Warner. Well, it is Warner Brothers because that was my first studio. And, you know, it was so thrilling to be a member. And I loved it. I loved it. But things didn't turn out very well in that, you know. I mean, I was expected to create havoc. But, you know, I mean, it was disappointing, one film after another. And then I got worse film, worse film, worse film. And finally, and I dyed my hair dark again. It was blonde, got blonder. They said, if you don't dye your hair back blonde, we're going to drop you. And I said, drop me, which they did. I did MGM and 20th Century Fox and Columbia, I think.
That's
and
right.
Then at the end of it all, I mean, my life had come tragedy. It really had. I mean, everything had gone wrong. I decided to go back to New York.
And at Warner Brothers, did they, when they had you under contract, did they take you through publicity duties? Did you have to go on photo shoots?
Oh, yes, I had to do all that, you know. And I had to do, for cigarettes, was it Chesterfields? All those things I had to do.
Did some directors want you to go see the Rushes when you were making a picture?
Oh, yes, we always saw the Rushes at that point in life. I mean, you know, I wouldn't miss the Rushes. It was good.
Why was it good?
Well, I just wanted to see what I'd do, you know, what I should do and that sort of thing.
Cookie's Fortune.
Yeah.
And that was directed by Robert Altman.
Robert Altman, who was very good. I don't know why I didn't think about that, to talk about that. And he's won awards. It's very good.
Was that a good experience for you, being on the set with those actors in that picture?
Well, you see, I was the first one. First shot was me, and they got rid of me quickly. I was there 2 weeks at the great location, but I was just there. 1 week doing tests and makeup, and they shot me in 8 days, and then I left. and then they got with the other scenes.
Now, you've done stage, television, the movies. Was there one that you preferred?
Well, I wanted to be a stage actress, you see, and I got off to a good start, but then Hollywood wanted me, so I answered their call.
Tell me about Lillian Hellman.
Oh, well, I love Lillian Hellman was something. When I got that part, I was understudying Voice of the Turtle. And I went, well, sorry, Richard Rogers. He kept reading me for everything. Well, I'd gotten the lead in John Loves Mary that day or 2 days before, and I was I went to the studio, the theater, to understudy, and this woman, she was in the alley, and she said to me, "Would you like to read for Lillian Hellman for another part of the forest?" And I said, "Oh, I can't. I've got a job." Well, she panicked, and she said, "Oh, please, please, you must come." And I said, "Okay." So I went, and I read for it, and I got it at once. So I could choose which part I wanted. Well, I wanted to do Lillian Hellman's play. So I chose that one, and then it was very good for me. It wasn't the big hit that The Little Foxes was. We thought it would be, but it didn't turn out to be that big. But it ran for about 6 months, and it was good.
And what was Lillian like as a director?
Well, she wasn't the best. Not the best, I don't think. But, you know, I mean, I like her very much. And she introduced me to my ex-husband, Roald Dahl.
But she wasn't scared to tell you when you were doing something wrong.
Oh, no. She wasn't scared of a thing. Not one thing. But she... No, I liked her. You know, she was, I said something that she didn't like. I think, I don't know, I forget what it was, and I got a rude letter from her then. But, no, I liked her. She was a beauty. And Dashiell Hammett, who was my great friend, he was her man for years and years. And Dashiell, he was beautiful to me.
And he stood up for himself during the blacklist.
Yes, he did, and I loved him. You know, and I mean, I'm not very, I'm not very good about politics. I mean, I just love some people, and you know, I mean, I don't care what he thought. I really didn't, because I loved him. And he was good.
I'd like you to tell me about your friend Jean Hagen.
Oh, Jean, she was, we had gone to Northwestern together, Northwestern University, but we weren't good friends there. We were at the speech school. But she was a good friend of Helen Horton, Petey Davidson, and we had roomed together when I first went to New York. And I just was a block away from them, two floors up in a tiny room, which had a public, you know, not a private bathroom, you faced a wall. And I said, and Helen said, you know, could you share the room with Jean? And I said, oh, sure, you know, I had a three-quarter bed. And we, so she came and we slept in that bed, and then we got tired of that, so we moved into a bigger one, about two blocks up. And then we moved all the way across town to a fabulous apartment, and I forget what happened. Then I went to Hollywood, and Jean was with me in another part of the forest.
I think most people know her as the ditzy actress in
yeah.
Singing in the Rain, but tell me, can you describe her as an actress? Was she versatile?
Oh, she was divine. She really was. I liked her so much, and she was... I think that was her most important film, was it not? But she was a good woman. She became an alcoholic, and that destroyed her. But then she was cured at last. And she was a great woman, you know, and I saw her, but she... Then her life was over. It was terrible, you know. And her daughter, I love her very much, you know. Anyway, these things happen.
Another good friend of yours was Mildred Dunnock.
Oh, yes. I adored Mildred Dunnock. She was my mother in another part of the forest. And She thought I was so radiant. She would watch me all the time on the set. She just liked my looks or something. But I adored her. She was good. And then we were in another part of the forest together. We did, and she was in the thing when I had my stroke.
Miss Neal, what are your memories of The Breaking Point, which was a book based on To Have and Have Not by Hemingway?
Yeah. I adored doing that, and I know that John Garfield, he was the leading man, and I met him at a party, and he would say, it was funny because he'd say, you're a whore, you know what I mean? You know what I mean? And then I'd say, yes, I know what you mean. Then he'd say, you know, you're hard to go to. You know what I mean? You know what I mean? He'd always say, you know what I mean? You know what I mean? So it was fun to do. But I love doing it. I love doing it. It was Phyllis Thaxter's first film. And she's a divine girl. I really see her occasionally in Florida. And, you know, I love her. I think it turned out to be a very good film. I like it. I think it's the best ever. It's the best ever by Hemingway.
And I agree with you. Good. And that was directed by, some people would say, a bully, Michael Curtiz.
Yes, Michael Curtiz. He was something. I did two films with him. Yeah.
Would he bully you, or was he nice to you?
Well, I bullied him. Oh, that was fun.
Is there one screen role to date that's your favorite?
Well, I love playing it in HUD, Alma, and I like playing it with Elia Kazan in A Face in the Crowd. And I like doing the one with Otto Preminger. I think that those are my favorites. I still think that The Day the Earth Stood Still, that's very popular. I think it'll be the most popular one I've ever made, really.
And there's somebody, it occurs to me, I'd like to ask you about Duke Wayne.
Oh, Duke Wayne. Now, first time I worked with Duke Wayne, I didn't like him very much. He was trying to direct it, and he was a horrible man. He almost beat up a young publicity man, you know. But then, I didn't like him. But then, some years later, I worked with him in Harm's Way. Well, he was fabulous. I really loved him then. I mean, he didn't try to direct it. He was the actor in it, and we got along superbly. I loved him.
Did you think he was a good actor?
Yeah, he was good, baby. He was good on the screen.
And lastly, tell me about the Patricia Neal Center, what it does.
Oh, the Patricia Neal Rehabilitation Center is just a fabulous hospital. I adore it. It's in Knoxville, Tennessee, and it's a superb one. And if anybody lives near and they have a terrible automobile accident or they have a stroke, oh, it's a super hospital to be in.
Now, if you could talk to the young Patsy Neal, if you could talk to her now, what advice would you give her?
Me? I just do your best, baby. Just do your best.
That's it.
That's all I can say.
All right. Thank you very much.
Thank you.